Hello friends, welcome and thank you for coming to my stream today. Hope you're all doing excellently. So I'm going to start with Historic today. The deck I have in front of me is Azorius or Blue-White Auras. It's a deck that's kind of been around for a long time but was enhanced with the addition of Kaladesh Remastered and the printing of Stram Senior Edificer to MTG Arena. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to record five matches on the ladder as a video to go up on the channel Fireball and the YouTube channel. And what that means is that the first thing I'd like to do is give a shout out to my two excellent sponsors, the best sponsors that a guy could ask for. The first, of course, is Ultimate Guard, who's a longtime creator of pretty much any product that you might use for gaming or TCG related stuff. If you're watching live on stream, you can find information about them in the panels below my stream. And if you're watching later on YouTube, we'll have hopefully a link for you, or you can check them out, their online catalog at ultimateguard.com or their Twitter account. And then my other sponsor, of course, is Channel Fireball. We're doing our best with the CFB Pro project. If you're not a member of CFB Pro, it's easy. There's a lot of different payment options. Some of them pay you back more than your investment in Channel Fireball store credit. So you can kind of choose a timeline, a membership option that fits your needs. Get access to all my written content and all my teammates' written content. Should be very, very helpful for you if you're somebody who enjoys reading and watching Magic strategy content. Remember, if you do any business with Channel Fireball, sign up for Pro or anything else, you can use my affiliate code Reid. That's R-E-I-D, just like my name. I do appreciate that. All right, so here we go with Azorius Auras. Yep. Now, I think a lot of your best hands have Core Spirit Dancer, or at least SRAM, as a turn 2 play. But there's absolutely nothing wrong with just suiting up a 1-drop creature. In particular, the Alcyid has Lifelink built in, which is important for creature matchups. Alright, no Fatal Push is good news. So I guess one option is I can go Island Curious Obsession and then pass with Karmetra's Blessing open to protect my enchanted creature. One thing to consider is if they had had Fatal Push, they probably would have cast it right away. So now we're getting in the realm of watching out for board sweepers instead of spot removal. However, you know, what's the upside of casting another one mana aura? It's like, I guess I spend my mana, but I'm not really increasing my damage output that much. I'm not outsizing my creature past like Languish or Yeheni's Expertise. So I think I'll just keep up Karmetra's Blessing this turn. All right, so there's the Spirit Dancer. Hopefully I'll draw a white source of mana next turn and I can start, you know, really doing my thing. All right, well actually the passing with Blessing is working out, you know, as I need it to work out. Okay. So this turn, it seems like it's going to be Spirit Dancer Aura. the primary question is, do I want to put the aura on the Spirit Dancer or on the Alcyid? I'm thinking on the Alcyid. So let's go with Spirit Dancer. Cartouche on the Alcyid. That'll make a 1-1, kind of diversify my threats against spot removal or extinction event. Though, if I was reading my opponent specifically for Languish, it would be better to put it on the Spirit Dancer, but I think Extinction Event and Spot Removal are much more likely than Languish or Yeheni's Expertise here. Good morning, Bubonic Indie. Thank you for the sub and your continued support. It's been a while since I've streamed, but I'm happy to be back. Happy to see everybody. And Christo, thank you also for the sub. Wow, double Fatal Push. So, I said on turn two that if they had had a spot removal spell, they may have played it already. I guess I was just dead wrong about that. Which, that's part of Magic, is you should always kind of factor in the possibility that you're wrong about something. I think I do want to just unload damage so that I can get the game over with, even through an Uro escape. Make this creature big in case of the off chance of Languish. It's kind of interesting, these games, like balancing, playing around all the possible stuff that they could have. A card I'm thinking a lot about is Extinction Event, which is the reason that I put Staggering Insight on the Alcyid. Okay, and here we go. It actually is Extinction Event. All right, I do not have lethal. I can double Sentinel's Eyes. I probably want to prioritize getting the Hushbringer out there. I could grab the Lurrus. Yeah, I'm thinking just attack, play Hushbringer, grab Lurrus. Maybe I throw one Sentinel's Eyes. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, Hushbringer has a really interesting relationship to Uro. Like, the nightmare scenario is that I play Hushbringer on turn 2 and my opponent plays Uro on turn 3 and it's just on the battlefield. But at this point, when they have one in the graveyard, their life total is super low. The fact that I can actually turn off the gain 3 life is going to be a determining factor in this game. So, this is threatening lethal already. A number of ways I could do this. I could give protection from green. I could also just suit up the Hushbringer and attack with two lethal threats. Okay, so this video and stream that I'm producing right now is connected to a deck guide that I'm also publishing about auras on the Channel Fireball website. I'm just going to follow as close as I can to my own sideboard guide that I wrote for that deck guide. So against Sultai, under the circumstances where I don't have deck lists. That's my normal sideboarding. I said second Disdainful Stroke is fine if I think they have multiple extinction events. I did see one extinction event there. But sure, we'll go with this for now. Nope. Well, this might be a game that I need Lurrus to do some work. I don't have quite the explosive start that I had in game number one. Shocking with the breeding pool. That should indicate like a heartless act, maybe a negate, eliminate. Can't be growth spiral, notably. That is actually one, I think, very real possibility is that my opponent had Growth Spiral, but just didn't appreciate the basic swamp, being a problem there. But negate's also super possible. So I should be aware of both of those things. Well, so far 1-1 beatdown is going okay. I think I want to hold up Spell Pierce. 4 mana is kind of the crucial point for a board sweeper. Or they could grow spiral into Nissa. Yeah, zero coin in the chat suggests maybe they have removal, but they're saving it for a two-drop creature. That's possible, though it kind of doesn't make as much sense when I have all these creatures that protect my other creatures. Like spot removal is not going to be very effective against this hand. Extinction Event will be effective if they can find a sixth land. And Digital Dead, thank you for the sub. Boy, not so much of an auras deck this game, huh? Granted, I did sideboard out a couple of auras, but just all 1/1 creatures. Tazrik, thanks for the sub. I actually probably should have pierced that because if they paid the mana, then they couldn't have escaped Uro. This is the downside of Spell Pierce against a Thoughtseize deck is, you know, if they see it and leave you with it, then they can just play around it. Although that, you know, after all said and done, it is doing its job there. Alright, so the fact they have both Languish and Extinction Event makes it a little difficult to play around stuff. I think I'm gonna throw the good game there. And yeah, happy enough with this. I could consider the second Disdainful Stroke, but I'm just gonna run it. KSW, thank you for the sub. All right, let's hope for a Core Spirit Dancer that survives. No turn one Thoughtseize, please. Alright, we're off to a really good start. The Protected Spirit Dancer, Spell Pierce for a possible Extinction Event. This is just where you want to be on the play in this matchup. So another All That Glitters is going to give plus 6, would make an attack for 14. I think I want to prioritize keeping the Spell Pierce open. Sentinel's Eyes would give plus 4, making an attack for 16. We're getting real close there, but since I can't actually have lethal, I want to hold up Spell Pierce. So they have to name even. Leaves me the Selfless Savior, and two auras on that should be just barely lethal. I guess if the game was going to continue, I should play the Spirit Dancer first, but I have lethal, so that's fine. And all right, getting out of what I generally consider to be a tough matchup with a win, that's a good start. Excellent hand, just what I want. Looks like swamps and thought seizes are popular today. Jund, huh? So normally the Jund color combination is a sacrifice deck that plays mostly creatures and Giganta as a companion, but this must be just some kind of Jund, you know, homebrew deck. All right, what do I want to do here? I think SRAM, you know, attack for one, SRAM pass is ideal. Because it sets me up that if I get to untap with either one of these creatures, I can get my card draw engine purring. Ouch. Discard, discard, removal, removal. That's pretty bad. Now I have to get to the stage where I'm leaning on Lurrus to get me out of this mess. No more discard, please. So something like another stomp would make sense here because my opponent, you know, played the one drop instead of playing the giant from the adventure zone. But now they need one more answer, because if I'm able to suit up the Alcyid, then I could still win this game despite my opponent having the flurry of interaction right away. Oh boy, that's what we needed. Now I get to play the Alcyid, protect it from a fatal push, and that should be, you know, well on the way to good game here. Now, sadly, I don't have a sideboard guide for Jund. I mean, I probably want to sideboard not much. Normally, Apostle is really good against the Fatal Push deck, but they have burn spells to take care of it as well. All right, actually, my opponent doesn't even want to play the sideboard game, so that is what it is. some kind of colorless deck. Oh no! You're supposed to be a colorless deck. Alright, so I'm left with my warrior, and then I get to fetch for Lurrus, but that is definitely a huge setback. I thought this was going to be a smooth, easy win. I guess I should have manually tapped the three planes for the Lurrus. Miso, thank you for the sub. I appreciate it. And Garewill, thank you also.
Evil must not be tolerated. Some solutions must be built.
So I have 22 cards in my library. Now I have 2 cards in my library. I guess I'll just throw a 1/1 in front of the Ulamog, and I mean, it's just win next turn or bust. No, come on. Well, I normally consider this to be a pretty good matchup, but Extinction Event, I mean, the double Extinction Event is what my opponent needed to swing the match in their favor. Arcane Flight was actually kind of good that game. Maybe I'll keep the flights and cut like the Sentinel's Eyes or something like that. No creature means mulligan. Ooh, 6 card hand with no creature. I do have Spell Pierce, which can tag the turn 2 Accelerant. I guess it's okay. I don't think I would keep on 7, but having taken a mulligan, you know, my opponent also taking a mulligan. I'm sure there was no need to shock myself there. My opponent, you know, doesn't play anything on turn 1. That was just kind of absent-minded and not necessary. I guess they could hypothetically have Thought Seize, but not very likely. Wonder why they would get Grafdigger's Cage when the Lyris is already gone.
Oh,
Well, I feel like I lost this match basically to the card extinction event and not specifically to the archetype that my opponent had chosen to bring.
Determine the course of history. Allow me to introduce you to a friend of mine.
All right, I think we've seen enough here. Sometimes the one landers are tempting. I think that I should not keep this one land seven card hand. By the way, my opponent has also revealed Lurrus, so it could be an Aura's Mirror. It could be Rakdos Arcanist. Uh-oh. Sure. Ouch. Well, I mean, if there's a way back in this game, it probably involves Spirit Dancer. And that is a great draw. Yeah, just way too much interaction. Plus, I did mulligan five that game. Well, I do get to sideboard a lot here. One, two, three, four, five, six. I'll try that. Meanwhile, Zoltar Prime and Itatog, I appreciate the subs. Welcome. All right, so I can either go Spirit Dancer Aura, or I could grab Lurrus. I think Spirit Dancer Aura is better. Make them have the answer. Grab Lurrus that turn because I don't really want play a creature and an aura into open Fatal Push mana. So at least try to make things slightly inconvenient for the opponent. Well, now this is going to be very tough, having to play against that active Arcanist. I mean, I almost want to just wait until I draw Rest in Peace or Grafdigger's Cage. Is that reasonable? Yeah, I kind of feel like I'm just in the lock here, waiting to draw Rest in Peace or Grafdigger's Cage, because any single creature that I play, the Dreadhorde Arcanist, basically just kills for free. So I think when you play a game like this, it's easy to get frustrated and just kind of like play your cards because you feel like you need to do something. But I think the actual one realistic route that I have to victory here is just waiting to draw Rest in Peace or Grafdigger's Cage. Although even that window is closing very quickly now with the Young Pyromancer Village Rites engine. You know, I probably have one last draw step in this game before it's completely over. So I sack the one that Fatal Push is targeting to give the other one protection from red, which threatens a block on Young Pyromancer. Again, I think, you know, with the opponent having seven cards, this game is basically over, but there's no reason to concede until I'm actually at zero life. Sure. So 6, 9, 11, 12, 13, 14 damage. Okay, I think we're done here. That seems like a nightmare matchup. Just every card is like a one mana spell that kills my creature or makes me discard. Sure. Can hope that SRAM survives in this hand. Well, a rematch against the colorless deck. I said last time that it was the extinction events as individual cards, not the archetype overall, that I felt beat me. Here's maybe a chance to make good on that prediction. Might as well, right? Sure. Okay, I got a game. That feels good because I was on a bit of a losing streak. I'm gonna sideboard differently this time. Still bringing in the four counter spells. This time I want to cut Karametra's Blessing, and yeah, two Hushbringers still fine. I think I'm gonna ship the Staggering Insight. My life total shouldn't matter that much in the early stages of the game. Hey, Yellow Hat, thank you for the raid. Welcome to all the Yellow Hat people. Currently playing Auras for a video for Channel Fireball. I'm in the fifth match. I'm 2-2, hoping to get revenge on this colorless ramp deck. Just look and find some blue mana, please. Des, thank you for that message. That's a really kind thing to say. Alright. So my opponent may charge the Blast Zone end of turn. I don't really mind if they're Blast Zoning for two. It's going to kill all their artifact mana. Let's see. This can also become a 2-2 blocker. If I predict them using Blast Zone, probably my play is just Selfless Savior. However, it's so bad for the purposes of using my mana. Maybe I should cast All That Glitters on the token. Let's try that. Man, no luck finding lands. This is now turn 4. On the draw, so I'm like 7 cards deep in my library without finding a land. Okay, so we got Blast Zoned. Have to just start rebuilding one way or another. Still no lands. Opponent at 4. Okay, so I'll do this time Selfless Savior and Sentinel's Eyes. Make them Blast Zone for 1, that's fine. That's pretty smart to Blast Zone at instant speed so I can't re-up the Sentinel's Eyes. Okay, at least I'm finding lands now, but still no blue mana. Still gonna be on my opponent to find something. Okay, Blast Zone for one again seems to be their only play at instant speed. So what does that mean? That means I want to do a Staggering Insight. Okay, Revenge. Alright, so that puts me at a 3-2 record, but because I had promised 5 matches, but since one of my matches was a premature concession from an opponent, I'll go ahead and play a 6th. Alright, looks like probably a Jund Sacrifice deck. Korvald. All right, let's be sure to make something good happen before Korvald hits the battlefield. Okay. I think I just let this die. Note that if I sacrifice it, it would trigger the Mayhem Devil again. Could save it with Karmetra's Blessing, but I think the Blessing in hand is more valuable than the Alciid on the table. Okay, so now the blessing is to try to protect the Spirit Dancer from Acclaim the Firstborn. That's hopefully the only answer my opponent's going to have to a creature with 9 toughness. I think blocking here is fine. So note that a non-flying creature is not really going to connect through a bunch of chump blockers and a Woe Strider. The Arcane Flight is kind of big here, but they still have Gilded Goose to block. Just going to attack with Spirit Dancer and then play Hallowed Fountain untapped to have Karmitra's Blessing again. So again, mostly just worried about the card Claim the Firstborn. So what's the move here? Start with SRAM. And then Arcane Flight on... Does it matter? I guess this one. Alright, kind of just looking for that last Arcane Flight, I guess. Yeah, good question in the chat. Hushbringer does not shut off the sacrifice trigger of a devil. It would shut off something like Midnight Reaper. Corvald, sure. Also, the Woe Strider is huge because if they can't sacrifice the creature that's blocking the lifelinker, then I'm going to get basically out of range. So here I think I can just start loading up the lifelink creature. And the cartouche is actually going to be lethal. Two lethal flyers is enough. And that's a core spirit dancer for you. My opponent was doing lots of powerful stuff, but the unanswered spirit dancer is just too much. Double Glacial Fortress, not ideal, but this is a good hand. Alright, let's get the card draw rolling. Try to hit land drops, find some interaction, ways to rebuild if my creatures get killed. Man, I would really love to hit a land drop, please. Thank you. All right, so the objective here is just to get Korvald into chump block mode. And the best way to do that, I think, is all that glitters. Almost find lethal here with the Alcyid. But not quite. Well, now I get to kill the Korvald, but I may have left myself dead to a claim the Firstborn. Oh, my opponent definitely needed to sack to the Wostrider there. That was not great. All right, so that's 4-2 with auras. I think every one of my opponents was playing black, which is the color you don't want to see. You don't want to face those extinction events, thought seizes, fatal pushes. So kind of under tough conditions, but I do think this deck, has its role in the metagame and is one that you could enjoy and be successful with if you pick it up. So I hope you enjoyed watching. Remember, if you are going to do any business with Channel Fireball or sign up for CFB Pro, you can use my affiliate code, REID, Reid, just like my name.